On a clear day, we can see forever. This is Clear Word Wednesday. A few moments in God's Word, designed to help you to see God's eternal purpose. Join us as we see clearly into God's Word.
Today on Clear Word Wednesday, we're looking at a topic, a way of escape. Our scripture reading is based off of 1 Corinthians 10 and verse 13, which says, "You have no temptation taken you, but such as is common to man. But God is faithful, who will not suffer you to be tempted above that you are able, but will with the temptation also make a way of escape, that you may be able to bear it." 1 Corinthians 10 and verse 13. On today's Clear Word Wednesday, we'll look at what the scripture doesn't mean, but most importantly, what it does mean. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, as we get into your word, O Lord God, we just invite your presence to be here with us. Thank you, O God, for the indictment of your Holy Spirit on our lives, O God, today. I pray, Father, that your word will go through with the utmost clarity, I pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. This is one of those verses of scripture that has been grossly taken out of context to the detriment of souls. Today on Clear Word Wednesday, we'll seek to bring some clarity to this text. The first thing we need to notice is that this verse is dealing with temptation. You had no temptation taken you. This is the subject of the verse. But notice it goes on to say, but such as is common to man. Every temptation, friends, that has assailed humanity for the past 6,000 years has been of the wash, rinse, repeat variety. We'll get more into that later on. What was laid at Adam's feet is also presented to you and to me. The packaging may be different, but the present remains. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life is not of the Father. Then comes this grand truth, but God is faithful, who will not suffer you to be tempted above that you are able. Let's just shorten this to a bite-sized portion. God is faithful. Notice now the thoughts under consideration. God does not put more on us than we are able to bear. That's point number one. Point number two, he will make a way of escape. A lot of times, this verse is used to say that all the things that happen to us is coming from God. This couldn't be further from the truth. But let's say God is the one who gave you cancer. When someone tells you, God will not give you more than you're able to bear, doesn't really foster hope now, does it? No. In fact, it cements the thought even more that this is from God. For this to link to the first part of the verse, it most definitely means that God is the one who gave you cancer. But the verse implies cancer is a temptation you are called to bear. But the Bible is clear, my friend. Let no man say when he is tempted, I am tempted of God. For God cannot be tempted with evil, neither tempted he any man. Therefore, friends, when you or I or anyone is, pardon the pun, tempted to say, God, why are you doing this to me? Understand, friend, that he is not. Every good gift and every perfect gift is from above, and cometh down from the Father of lights, with whom is no variableness, neither shadow of turning. James 1, 13 and 17. Friends, notice this. The absolute truth is, God does not bring temptation on anyone. Neither does he put anything on you. Everything that you bear from God occurs voluntarily. In other words, when you pray for patience, humility, so on and so forth, God doesn't force that on you. In fact, what he will allow is that you will go through situations that will cause you to have patience, humility, so on and so forth. For example, in that, you're waiting on the bus stop for the bus and it's taking forever. Instead of you hopping and popping and looking down the street to see when the bus is coming, you'll notice the person next to you and seek to strike up a conversation and win them to Christ, for example. Continue on. God only gives good gifts, friends, and any way you slice it, any way, cancer is bad. In fact, it is used as a metaphor for sin. God does permit us to pass through certain dark valleys, that's for sure, but only as part of the refining work, and he never engineers the trials. And with these, there is no let up until the work is done. Being tempted of Satan and tried by God are meant to affect two vastly different outcomes. In other words, friends, remember Jesus said, my yoke is easy, so we are called to bear some yokes. We are called to go through things, but only for our refinement. And these things, like I said, are brought about by God. But in fact, you, my friend, are praying for humility, for patience, for more love, for more tolerance, for more. And God's allowing you to be refined for the rough path to be taken off of you. And it may seem the same work like it would be if you're being called to endure something that you're not. You're not called to endure certain things, my friend. We don't have time to get into all the minute details, but certain things that come upon us, as I often say, are fires of our own kindling. So now that we touched up our thinking on what this verse does not mean, let's finish our time together by showing clearly what it does mean and the way of escape. Dealing with being tempted, the Bible says, "Wherefore, let him that thinketh he standeth take heed lest he fall." That's verse 12 of 1 Corinthians 10. And then verse 13 goes on to the same part, "Ye have no temptation taken you." Did you see the connection, friend? First off, let's make it clear. Being tempted is not the same thing as sinning. Every child of God is tempted. The temptation takes you when you give into it and fall. Remember, the angels in heaven, as well as Eve, were also tempted. That's why the admonition is given in the chapter, "Take heed." You know, many of us, I dare say the majority of us humanity, don't like to take heed. I mean, if the boss tells us to do something and it's going to net us a paycheck, sure, the teacher, again, a good grade, parent, good allowance, so on and so forth, then sure, why not? We'll endure it for a season. But certain things just gnaw at us and we're like, why do I have to do this? Ah, but friend, in this instance, take heed. Don't think that you are above the wiles of the enemy. Friend, we're told that he's like a roaring lion. And what more ferocious imagery do you need than to take heed from? However, before we deal with the last section, let's address the fact that we do not have to sin. And that's just it. We do not. We can only be tempted, some more severe than others, but we do not have to give in. Notice how James says temptation takes us. He says every man is tempted when he is drawn away of his own lust and enticed. Then when lust hath conceived, it bringeth forth sin, and sin, when it is finished, bringeth forth death. James 1, verses 14 and 15. But as long as we choose to abide in Christ, we do not have to sin. More on this later. Notice what John the Apostle says. "Whosoever committeth sin transgresseth also the law, for sin is a transgression of the law. And we know that he was manifested to take away our sins, and in him is no sin. Whosoever abideth in him sinneth not. Whosoever sinneth hath not seen him, neither know him. Little children, let no man deceive you. He that doeth righteousness is righteous, even as he is righteous. He that committeth sin is of the devil, for the devil sinned from the beginning. For this purpose the Son of God was manifested, that he might destroy the works of the devil. Whosoever is born of God doth not commit sin, for his seed remaineth in him, and he cannot sin, because he is born of God." James, that was 1 John 3, 5-9. "Blessed is a man that endureth temptation, for when he is tried, he shall receive the crown of life, which the Lord hath promised to them that love him." True story, that word corona, as in coronavirus, means crowns. God has not promised to give us that crown, so don't claim that. Claim that which is mentioned here in verse 12 of James 1. "Blessed is a man that endureth temptation, for when he is tried, he shall receive the crown of life." Endure here is the same as bear in 1 Corinthians 10 and verse 13. It does not mean that God gives us strength to fight Satan. Just the opposite, friends. We give God the authority to stand up for us. How? This is our last point before we close the way of escape. "Submit yourselves therefore to God," the Bible says. "Resist the devil and he will flee from you. Draw nigh to God and he will draw nigh to you." James 4, verse 7 and 8. At the heart of 1 Corinthians 10, verse 13, is a truth most Christians do not accept. And I say most purposely. Sin is a choice. As long as we are in this world, yes, we have a work of resistance to do. But being in a warfare with sin doesn't make us prone to sin. No, rather, it positions us as soldiers. Let me say that one more time. It positions us as soldiers. We are often told we will sin as long as we are in the flesh. What's wrong with this is that the heart of the conclusion of the study, Jesus did not die to save us in sin, but from sin. 1 Corinthians 10:13 shows us the way of escape. We are told in Scripture, Thy word have I hid in my heart, that I might not sin against thee. Psalm 119:11. Seeing then that we have a great high priest that is passed into the heavens, Jesus the Son of God, let us hold fast our profession, for we have not an high priest which cannot be touched with the feeling of our infirmities, but was in all points tempted like as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore come boldly unto the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. Hebrews 4, verse 14 to 16. And finally, the Bible says, Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. That's Jude 1, 24. We are never to seek to resist temptation under our own power, that is. You may have the wisdom to know how to build a motor car, the strength to lift one, or the riches to own the most expensive one. But in dealing with sin, riches, wisdom, and might are powerless. Only in humility, by surrendering the situation to God, will there be a way of escape. Applying the living, spoken, active, and written word to your circumstances will breed good results. Once you've learned to trust God in every facet of your walk, Satan and all his angels will soon learn that they best move on to easier prey. But that doesn't mean you are home free. We'll discuss this next time we meet on Clear Word Wednesday. Until then, stay abiding in God's word so you may see clearly even in the darkest days. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, we come to you now at the end of the study, thanking you so much, Father, for the heart that you have given unto us, a heart to surrender to your will. Today, we have seen that this verse here, 1 Corinthians 10:13, has been so misunderstood, so misapplied, so abused, dear God, so wrongly interpreted, so wrongly applied. And so today, we just wanted to bring clarity to this verse. It's not saying that you do put things on us that we're not able to get out of. In fact, we know, dear God, that you don't put anything on us. And we know, dear Heavenly Father, that a lot of times people think that things that they're called to bear are so overwhelming. But Lord God, only you know what your creation is able to bear, O God. And so, Father, if there's anything in us, Lord God, that needs to be purged out, Lord, Father, weigh that upon our hearts today and speak to us like never before, so that only Christ could be seen in us and nothing of our own. Lord, we love you, O God. We praise you. We serve you. We thank you. We magnify your holy name, O God. And so this morning, as we come to you, God, we just want to say thank you so much for your loving kindness and your tender mercy. We just want to say, oh God, thank you so much for dealing with us. Today, Heavenly Father, on this Clear Word Wednesday, I ask you, oh God, to please speak to the listening audience and help them to understand that you and only you know what your word means because you wrote it. But if we are in you, we too will know. So, Holy Father, give us a heart to know your word so that we can make every day a clear word that we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you for joining me today on this Clear Word Wednesday.
You have been listening to Clear Word Wednesday. Join us again next time for more insight on God's clear word.